Welcome to Information Service Engineering. This is lecture number 4, Natural Language Processing, part 3. In this part of the lecture, we are going to talk about so-called finite state automata. Okay, you might remember that in the last lecture, we have ended with so-called regular expressions, which are powerful tools to create search patterns, rather flexible search patterns. And with this kind of regular expressions, you can create so-called regular languages. So therefore, regular expressions are one way to characterize regular languages. What's a regular language? This is a so-called formal language. So formal languages from formal language theory in theoretical computer science. And this kind of formal language, the regular language, is the language that is defined with the help of a regular expression. Okay, however, there are more means to define exactly these kind of regular languages. Besides the regular expressions, regular languages can also be characterized by so-called finite state automata. This is a theoretical model of computation, like the Turing machine, that is as powerful as regular expressions. And with the help of a finite state automaton, you can recognize a regular language. And we know the guy already, Stephen Kleine. That's the one who introduced regular expressions back in the 1950s. He also showed an isomorphism between finite state automata and regular expressions, meaning that there is an isomorphic relation between these two. And he did this with the famous Kleine's theorem. On the other hand, another means to create regular languages are grammars, and here in particular so-called regular grammars. So regular grammars, also referred to as type 3 grammars, they correspond to regular languages. And Noam Chomsky, who also described this famous Chomsky hierarchy of languages, he gave a correspondence between different kind of automata and formal grammars. And on the other hand, he showed so that regular grammars are isomorphic to finite state automata. So this was Noam Chomsky. Okay, enough of the history. Let's have a closer look on finite state automata. So as I told you, a finite state automaton is kind of an abstract machine. And this kind of machine can be in exactly one of a finite number of states at any given time. So the theory of abstract automata was developed by the mid-20th century in close connection with automata theory, which was initially considered a branch of mathematical systems theory, studying the behavior of discrete parameter systems. We don't have to care about that. It's only an addendum so that you have a bit of background information on finite state automata. So it's an abstract model of a computer, rather simple. What it does is it reads an input string. By reading the input string, it changes its internal state. It always can be at one time in one state. So this was one of the basic fundamental properties. And the way how this state change is taking place depends on the current input symbol. Thereby, an FSA can either accept or reject an input string. And each automaton defines a language. This means this is a set of string, which is accepted by this automaton. So that's an FSA, a finite state automaton. So usually if you draw a finite state automaton, you draw the states with the help of vertices or nodes. So this looks clearly like a graph. And then the state transition, they are these kind of arcs. You start at one end and you indicate that also that this one is the starting state. So Q sub zero here in our example is the starting state. And then you see here the state transitions. These are the edges between the nodes. And you see also what's the input string to be read. So if a B is read, then here the state Q sub zero changes to Q sub one. And the input pointer goes one step further. And in the end, if everything works out well, you will end up in a so-called accepting state. So then this automaton accepts the input string. So now let us think about what kind of words or string could be recognized by this finite state examples. Think a bit. Okay. Clearly, BAA exclamation mark. Or, since in Q3 we go back to Q3, or we have the possibility to go back to Q3 if the letter A occurs in the input, also BAAA exclamation mark, or 4 times A exclamation mark, or B 5 times A exclamation mark. We can easily write this with a regular expression, which would be BAA plus, you remember, plus means 1 up to n repetitions, and then the exclamation mark. So you see clear correspondence between regular expression and a specific finite state automaton. So this automaton is fairly simple. Accepted strings then would be, for example, BAA exclamation mark or the B4A exclamation mark. However, other kind of strings that contain, for example, let's say letters which are not in our alphabet that has been used for the state transitions will not be accepted. So ABC is not an accepted string, so we will never end up in the accepting state. Or BABB, this is a sequence that is also not accepted, while it only contains letters that are also here in the so-called input alphabet, but it's not accepted. So you see that's the power of exactly that kind of automaton. It tries to match it. So it's also used then for string matching like regular expressions, and it implements regular expressions more or less. The different state transitions, of course, you can write here in terms here of a graph and label each edge then with the letter that is then responsible for a specific state transition. Or you can also write a state transition table. What you have there, you have the different states. So this is column one. And you have then the input symbols. This is the row number one you see here. So we have the input symbols A, B, and exclamation mark. And we have the states Q, sub 0, sub 1, sub 2, sub 3, and sub 4. And you see exactly what is going on there. So for example, if we consider the following situation, so that we are, for example, here in state Q sub 0. So that would be this one here, Q sub 0. And we encounter the input B, then we will end up here in Q sub 1. So this is pretty simple. However, of course, if you formalize an automaton like that, formalization doesn't mean you draw a graph. This is only a visualization of the automaton. Formally, in mathematics, you define the finite state automaton as a kind of tuple. So you define it, you say A is a tuple with the following components. So A consists of a capital Q, which is a set, a finite set in that sense, of the n states of which exactly this automaton consists of. So you can call them Q sub 0, Q sub 1, and so on, until Q sub n minus 1, if you have n states. Then you need the input alphabet that is read from the input tape. And this is sigma. Sigma is the set, or is the input alphabet of symbols. You need a designated start state. We call that here Q sub 0. You can also choose another one, but you have to definitely give us a start state. Where do we have to enter this finite state automaton? This must be clear. And then, of course, there can be final states. Not only one, there can be several finite states. So think of a complicated automaton where you have different ways to follow that of strings that are accepted. So you can also define different finite states. So F is also a finite set, which is a subset of Q. So this is then in the end, of course, potentially all states of Q might be finite states, but yeah, we define here capital F as the set of finite states. And of course, we have to define the transition function, which has two input arguments. One, Q is of course the state. So Q is of capital Q of the finite set of states. And you have I, which is then from sigma. So this is the letter from the input alphabet that occurs in the input. So delta, the transition function, is defined on Q times sigma and maps this again to Q. So the output will be another state. And of course, delta of Q and I is then another state, Q prime, which is both Q and Q prime from the set of states Q. However, if you write down the formalization of a specific automaton, of course, you denote then the transition form function in terms of a state transition table, as we have already seen it. So let's try to formalize sheep talk. Sheep talk in itself, okay, we have here Q, the set of states. We have four states, Q sub 0, Q sub 1, sub 2, sub 3, and sub 4. Our input alphabet, it's also rather simple here. Input alphabet A, B, and exclamation mark. So you see here also A, B, and exclamation mark, three symbols in sigma. The start state of our finite state automaton is Q sub 0. And we have only one final state, and this is Q sub 4. And here, although this is only one state, it's the set containing exactly this state. So F always gives you a set. Keep in mind, Q0, the start state is only a state, but the final state is always a set of states. And then you define delta, your transition function, with the help of a state transition table, which looks like that. You see it here. Okay. Now, there is also a real algorithm that describes how a finite state automaton might recognize a string and processes a string. And this algorithm is called derecognize, and I'm going to show it to you because it works really, really simple. But of course, we have to formalize it and we have to have a look at it. So we have here our finite state automaton. The current state, which is the start state, is denoted. And also we have the input tape and also the position of the index. So where do we start reading? The input tape is also indicated. So start state is Q sub 0. And the first letter here to be read on the index tape, so the index tape is this above here, it's a B. And then we can see here, okay, Q sub 0 and B, we will end up in Q1. So Q1 is then our next state we are in. So the current state then is Q1. And you see here the index moved on to A. And now we are looking at our table. We have state Q1. We have input letter A. Next state will be Q2. Okay, so we move on to Q2. Again, we will read A. And we are in Q2. So Q2 and A then results in Q3. Then we are in Q3. And also the next, the third A occurs here. And again, for A, we continue and end up again in the state Q3. However, then, if we read the very last one, then we are in Q3. We are reading the exclamation mark, and with the exclamation mark, we will end up in Q4. And Q4 is the final state, which means then here in Q4, no matter what occurs, nothing happens. We remain in the current state, which is the acceptance state. Q4 is the final state. The string is accepted. This is how a finite state automaton works, and you see this is really not really complicated. So the finite state automaton for our sheep talk again is shown here with a complete transition table. Let's go back to formal languages, which can be defined with the help of regular expressions or are the language that is accepted by a finite state automaton. So the formal language is a model that can both, it can generate and also recognize all and only those strings that are given by its definition. An automaton itself can only describe now an infinite set with the help of a so-called closed form, because the language is infinite. So you can make it longer and longer and longer and longer most times. So it's potentially infinite. However, you can describe then this infinite set of things with a closed form, which means in a rather short form. So how do we define a formal language? So we have here the example for our sheep talk model. We call that model M. And there, first of all, the alphabet, this is easy. So each formal language, we have already heard that, has an alphabet on which it's based on. So we have here B, A, and exclamation mark. And then we said, okay, you need a set of rules which define exactly, you know, the type of strings which are accepted, so which are part of the language. So With L of M, that's the language of M, we define the formal language that is characterized by the model. Our model here is then in the end, for example, the finite state automaton that accepts exactly that kind of language. And if you want to describe the language, then we simply give all the strings that are accepted by that language. We can write this, of course, here in a not closed form. So like B, A, exclamation mark, B, 3 times A, exclamation mark, B, 4 times A, exclamation mark, and so on. But we would have to continue forever. Another way to describe this in a closed form would be then a regular expression, or the definition here also of the finite state automaton, or a corresponding grammar. So grammars we don't consider here, but this is also possible. Usually then, this is a nice, property. It holds that the language itself is a subset of, this is sigma star. Sigma star is the Kleinis closure of the alphabet sigma, which means these are all possible strings. So this is the set, it's an infinite set of all possible strings that can be formed from the letters that are contained in the alphabet sigma. And of course, the language that is accepted, it's usually not all of them. This is kind of a subset of sigma star. Okay, so what can we now do with that? Of course, we know a formal language is, of course, not a natural language. So we are not able to really then consider natural language with it. However, parts of natural language we can model. And what we can model with a finite state automaton, so with a formal language, are parts of phonology, morphology, or syntax. So syntactic rules can also be excellently modeled with the help of regular languages. But we will look closer on the example of morphology, because morphology and morphological parsing, morphological analysis, can be performed based on finite state automata. Okay, simple example of, let's say, some language that can be accepted by a finite state automaton. Of course, this is also oversimplified, and probably you will do this in the end. If you want to accept amounts of money between 0 and 99 cents, then you have here a three-state, very, very simple automaton, which accepts, and here it's not only one character, here it's an entire word. Here in the first state transition from Q0 on that side to Q2, all numbers from 1 to 10 and then from 11 to 19, and then all between 20 and 99, you have these three-state transitions. So first, of course, you have the tens, which means 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, and so on, and then you have the last digit, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. So this would be an example for a three-state modeling amount of money. However, it's not completely correct. I see here now also 20, 30, and 40 should be ending up in a finite state. So Q1 should also be already a finite state. Okay. We want, in the end, a bit to improve the model of the finite state automaton. But this kind of improvement does not lead now, let's say, to more powerful or more semantics of things which are accepted. It's only a means of, you know, making these kind of formal machines a bit more compact. And for that, you can use so-called non-deterministic finite state automatons. In deterministic finite state automatons, this is what we have seen before, there is only one state transition, you know, possible if you encounter in a specific state a specific input letter. However, in non-deterministic finite state automatons, it's possible then to choose different ways. Like here, for example, if we look at it, if we are here in state Q2, if after that the letter A occurs, we can either stay in Q2 or we leave it and go to Q3. So you have these two possibilities. And however, then So you see, there are then more strings which can be potentially recognized with this kind of automaton than with only a deterministic one. So it's a bit more powerful. However, you could also extend the deterministic finite state automaton in a way that it's capable to grab or capture exactly the same kind of languages. In the state transition table, this would then look in the following way. You have the input symbol A, and in state Q2, instead of going to exactly one state, you go to a set of states, so to Q2 or to Q3. Which means then you have to change, of course, then here the transition function of the non-deterministic finite state automaton. So instead of, mapping a state and an input symbol to another state, you map it here to a power set, which means here this is 2 to the power of q, which means this is a set of the elements of q. And then, of course, applied an input alphabet character to a specific state will end up in q prime, q this time with a capital letter, where q prime is a subset of the original q. So this is one of the major differences here. So you see here also q2, q3. This has also here a mapping between the state transition table directly and the finite state non-deterministic automaton. Another way, and of course this is again to be seen so they are isomorphic, you can also model exactly the same kind of state transition with so-called epsilon transition. This is another helper way, or another way to define this, and these kind of helper transitions work then in the following way. So instead of, that I have here for Q2, let's say with the letter A, I end up in Q2, or I go then to another state Q3, I could go exactly the following way. I could, if an A occurs in Q2, go to Q3, and then potentially, if I want to, automatically switch back to Q2. So this is an epsilon transition, which means this is not a symbol that is actually occurring. But of course, when I'm here, either I go back or I continue. So this is an epsilon transition, and you see this is a direct mapping between the possibility you have here in the first line and in the second line. It's only mathematically then a bit different, which means then you stick here in the same way that you say, for example, I need another input symbol, and this here is the epsilon symbol. And of course, it's not an input in that way, because epsilon means this is nothing. So this you can decide either you follow it or not. The formal definition then changes also a bit. So again, here, if I have the transition function, of course, then I do not only look from sigma and q to map it to another subset of states from q. So sigma has to be extended in a way that I say sigma are the input symbols plus the epsilon symbol. And of course, the epsilon symbol should not be one of the original input symbols. So if I do the intersection of both, they should be disjunctive. So there should be an empty intersection. That's in the end all. So here, you see only then here, if I encounter a state and an input symbol, the input symbol then must be all from sigma sub epsilon, which means this is sigma also containing epsilon. But these are only mathematical subtleties that are not so important. In the end, it's only, you say often that syntactic sugar. Let's go back to our own original task. We want to use finite state automata for morphological parsing. So let's have a look at the task again. What we have there, we have kind of an input word, like the word cats. So this is our so-called surface form. We have already heard that expression. And the morphological parser creates from that surface form a lexical form, which means it gives us back the stem, which is cat. It tells us that the stem is a noun, so this is this plus m, n. And it gives us back that, of course, this is the plural form of the noun, so plus pl, which is the plural. So this would be the lexical form, the morphological analysis of our surface form cats. Okay, we want to build a finite state morphological parser. What do we need? First of all, we need a lexicon which contains a list of stems, of word stems. It also have to tell us what's the type of the word. So is it a noun, is it an adjective, and so on and so on. And we need all of the affixes somehow. Then we need so-called morphotactic rules. This is a model of morpheme ordering. So what is a prefix? What is a suffix? What's the order? So when is an affix a prefix? What follows after this affix? And so on and so on. So this is the morpheme ordering that has to be modeled. And in addition to that, like for example in English, we need further orthographic rules. This means spelling rules for certain morpheme combinations, like for example, Y becomes IE if I want to create the plural of a noun which ends on Y. So for example, in city, if I want to build the plural, we have an orthographic rule in English that says, okay, the Y will be changed to IE. Cities, the plural of city, is written C-I-T-I-E-S. So this kind of rules also have to be considered. So first of all, really important, we have the list of stems and types, and these kind of types usually are called also part of speech. So there it will be determined what exactly is this a word. So what's the category of the word? Is it a verb, an adjective, an adverb? So is it a number, whatever? So this determines then also, you know, the meaning of the word. So morphological parsing also determines whether I'm looking here at a verb or at a noun. Okay, in principle, it could work in the following way. So if we, for example, encounter a stem, then of course we could say, yeah, if the word consists only of a stem, we end up in an accepting state. If we have a prefix and a stem, so like for example in disgrace, we would have to first accept or to recognize the prefix and then the stem and then end up in an accepting state. The same holds also if we have something with a suffix, so we have graceful. So then we have first the stem, then the suffix. But, you know, we can derivate lots of interesting things out of grace. So we can also say disgraceful, consisting of a prefix, stem, and suffix, and then acceptance. Now, of course, to create for all of these possibilities, single automata would be, yeah, a bit of an effort. So what you do here is, and therefore we also introduced here the non-deterministic versions, we can combine all of these models into a single automaton, so into a single non-deterministic automaton. This is an automaton that accepts grace, disgrace, graceful, and disgraceful, simply by extending the original one with a new state and also with epsilon transitions, which means if I have grace, for example, I start in Q0, go directly to Q1, have the stem, and then end up here in an accepting state. Or for disgraceful, I go via Q0, recognizing the prefix to Q1, recognizing the stem to Q2, recognizing the suffix to Q3, and end up again in an accepting state. Hooray! So you see, the reason why we introduced exactly this kind of non-deterministic automata was simply, yeah, we need some means for abbreviations. Now, let's become a bit more concrete. We try now to come up with a simple finite state automaton for English nominal inflection, which means we try to create plural forms of nouns. So for the regular noun, we know we simply have to add an S. So this is then quite simple here. We have the regular noun that is here, the stem is recognized. And of course, the stem for a regular noun, not plural, would already be accepting. But then if follows an S, we also accept it and we see, yeah, it's a plural. Very nice. However, in English, there are irregular words that have an irregular plural. And all for these irregular words, for their plural form and for the singular form, we also have to introduce state transition from the beginning to to an accepting state. And we have to make clear that this, of course, has to be considered. However, you know, the input pointer goes character by character over the word. So we have to do this also with our automaton. And then, for example, if we want to do this here for a few English words, for example, dog, first we read an D, an O, and G. And then we would have an epsilon transition to the end, which means dog would be accepted. If after dog there is an S, we are also in an accepting state. If we have cat, C-A-T, and then again, singular, epsilon transition to accepting state, or plural, S, and then accepting state. So in this upper part, all of the regular nouns could be modeled. And then in the lower part, I have, for example, here some irregular nouns like goose and geese. Okay, one of the problems we haven't spoken so far is these finite state automata, they are able to accept a correct word if it's formed correctly according to the morphological rules. But it does not do the full job of morphological parsing, because morphological parsing requires not only to detect that this word has been correctly formed, we also want to find out A, the type of the noun or of the word, and we want to find out, yeah, the type of inflection, derivation, or whatever. So we want to find that out, which means we need an automaton that is not only to read, but that is also able to create, to write something. And this is also possible. A small extension of our finite state automaton would be a so-called finite state transducer, who is able on the same time to accept and to read an input character while at the same time transferring this character to another character, so writing a character. That would be a finite state transducer, and we will talk about finite state transducers in the next section of the lecture.